It's on the record. We start fall weather. We no longer have a summer, right? So we, this morning was a little bit chilly. I want to mention something. Anyone know where I can borrow a 8 millimeter movie projector? I have one at home. Last night I was trying to view the InstaVee movie that I have. Halfway through, my movie projector, the thread seems doesn't work. So I tried to repair till this morning about 2 o'clock. I couldn't get it working. So I give up on it. I saw the college I can borrow one. So I'm running around asking. I don't know where I can get one. So if some of you know the other place or Mathematic or somewhere, there's a two tape I kind of want you to see. One is the Toming selecting wave. That is a two Cartesian coordinate and a pair of flow instability. That it's very nice, you can see it. Another one is a rotating cuvette flow. You have a different cylinder rotating same wise and counter wise, and you have and the light is shining from inside tube out, so you from outside you can see what is going on there. If I can repair or anyone volunteer to help me to repair my Kodak 8 millimeter movie projector, I'll show you next time. I also bring two books. Maybe the last time I didn't show you. There's a book called Stability or Peril Flow. So this book deals everything peril. Okay, and this is by Robert Mitchell and the criminal. I think Mitchell was at Notre Dame University, if I'm not wrong. I had this book for some time, 1967, the first time they published it. Tend to be not so easy to read it, and also concentrate all the mathematics, they got to manipulate this and that. But if you are interested, you are certainly welcome to take a look or glance at. I don't know how many of you know the theory of laminar flow. This is the Princeton series. they have a total of 12 volume, and this is the laminar flow. I don't know if there is a one turbulent, but as far as the stability goes, yes, there is a volume edited by Professor C.C. Lin, which is affiliated with our math department, turbulent flow and heat transfer. It's a little bit old, but there is another volume there. There is a article, actually two articles. One is the stability by Professor Shen of Cornell, and another article by Professor Simon Ostrak, who is the chairman of our college advisory board. He wrote the thermal instability, and Shane wrote the regular instability, so the parallel flow and the rotating flow instability. So if you want to take a look, you're welcome to look at it. I certainly hope I will finish the stability today, because we got to move on our turbulent stuff. But let's quickly just back up to the general idea of hydrodynamic instability, or the stability in a sense that you can only give a small disturbance to analyze. You cannot do a lot of finite amplitude disturbance. The reason we want to know the stability is that we want to examine if it is indeed a turbulent star from triggering of this imperfections, a little bit of a gradient here, and it'll take off. So we will examine any kind of a flow, be it a parallel, rotating, three-dimensional, any flow. If you get a laminar flow there, and what you do in terms of examining the flow is stable and unstable, physically, I using my elbow, just give it a bump or give it like this, or just jump out of that and see what happens. And if it is the disturbance you impart to the flow, begin to take off, either in time or in space, then you call it unstable. If it is die out, you call it stable. If you get a disturbance, it cannot maintain its oscillation, then you call it neutrally stable. is neither stable nor unstable, so you call neutral stable. Now, mathematically, how to do it is that because of infinitesimal disturbance, let you get away the nonlinear term. So because the nonlinear term becomes very small, you throw it away. So mathematically speaking, equation, Navier-Stokes equation, under the disturbance conditions, just analyze the disturbance part of it, because you already know what kind of laminar flow you have. So the disturbance part of it, it becomes linear. Okay. Now, if it's a linear equation, then you know you can superpose a variety of the spectral Fourier wave and so forth. So you analyze the stability. We call it a normal mode analysis. That means you take a mode and analyze it. So take a spectra, take a frequency, take a wavelength, and see how this flow would amplify or not. If it's a takeoff, then you call it the flow is unstable. And this enables you to do a little bit simpler analysis, because you put it at wavelengths like this, see what happens. It die out. You give it a little bit shorter wavelength, see what happens. So you keep repeating the different input of the disturbance by just a single spectrum or single wave to see what happens. And that makes your analysis much, much simpler. And so that is all we've been doing. All some of our equations that way. The curve flow we're looking at the review a little bit today is also the same way. Okay? Now, of course, in the stability analysis, your basic laminar flow is there. So the instability depending on your flow, be it to be Coubert, be it jet flow, the wake flow. So every profile is going to have a different characteristic of the instability. That's why it's so tough. Every flow come up, you got to go and analyze it. Okay. Now, to quickly review it, we gone through the parallel flow. I have a homework assignment, and I think that is enough for turbulent class, not enough for stability class. That should give you some general idea of it. Now, the curve flow instability needs some discussion. Is that, as I said, if you have a parallel flow, which is a Cartesian coordinate, then you don't have a central figure force and Coriolis force, because everything is parallel. But once everything curves, I think every one of you, when you are children, I don't know, in the Jordan, you get to play merry-go-around or not. I don't know, Ms. Trinko in Russia, when you are children, you go to the park, jump on the something which is rotating, you jump on it. And once you stand up, you try to take a walk in there. When you lift the leg, what happens is the leg is going to go this way. You never be able to step the place you want to go, and that is the Coriolis force is acting on you, that you won't be able to step on. So anything rotates, you have a different kind of force acting on it. So it is going to create a different kind of instability that you have. So in terms of simplest curve flow, I said the basic is that you take only the cylindrical coordinate. Actually, curve flow doesn't have to be cylindrical. It can be many hyperbolic coordinate or the toroid coordinate, anything. So if we make it as a function of R only, that again is the simplest basic flow, then you got an equation like this. And today I add a couple of the drawing there when I was looking at my note here. Let me amplify a little bit here. Essentially, you were looking at the incompressible flow, and only curve flow is the only function of R. Okay, we make it very simple. But even with that one, you have a continuity equation and a three momentum equation there. Out of a three momentum equation, one is the radial direction, which is the u, and one is the azimuthal direction, which is the v. Another one is the axial direction, which is the g. And actually, even in the curve flow, in the cylindrical coordinate, the g coordinate actually is parallel, because the flow is going straight. Okay, so the only two actually involving a curve, one is, actually, radial is also straight. But radial, because of a cylindrical coordinate, you have this, the v square comes in. So you see centrifugal force here, and U and V interact to give you the Coriolis force. So that is the two force you got to realize. Now, one thing I want to point out here, you're looking at the centrifugal force, which is the V square. So it doesn't matter you rotate this way or rotate that way, it doesn't matter because it's always square and pointed out outward. But when you have a Coriolis force, which is the U times V, and now depending U is radial and the V rotating this way or that way, Coriolis force, one is going to act this way, one is going to act that way, okay? And that's why in the Earth's rotation, you know, the hurricane rotate different because it in the different direction there. So Coriolis force is going to act funny. So that means what? I draw these two pictures to cause your attentions. Looking at this one, if an inner cylinder rotate faster, outside slower. So inner side has a larger V square. That means the inner side has a little bit larger centrifugal force than the outside one. So that means the inside is going to push in very hard to go out. So it is going to overtake the outside. So this, right away, you have an intuitive feeling it's going to be unstable. Now this side, when the inner and the outside rotate at the different directions, now you got a problem here. Right at the nut where the zero velocity there, you don't have any. You don't have any centrifugal force at that point. Yes, you are imparted by the surrounding, but at that point you don't generate because V is zero, V square, nothing, right? But now you got a one going this way, one going that way, so you can see even the radial velocity is going to go outward. But one of the V go this way, one of the V go that way. Now you know that the Coriolis force is going to be different because of the term I just pointed out, Coriolis force here. UV multiply, and if one direction go, the Coriolis force just shift the direction there. So the instability occurred in this one is going to be messy. Going to be messy because Coriolis force acting a little bit different. Okay, I'm trying to explain the physics and let you have a feeling of why the curve flow occurred that way. Okay, I don't want to go through the detail of the analysis here. You can read the mathematics. And of course, I mentioned that this essentially is a concentric cylinder. I wish I can show you that movie, then you see that how that actually is moving. But you see this is from outside, you're shining the light to the concentric cylinder. Most likely, these are the oil mixed with aluminum flake. You know, the aluminum powder, which is very shiny, and you're mixing the oil, you're suspending the oil for a long time. So if an inner cylinder rotate, then there is going to move. And therefore, when you're shining the light, the particle move in a certain direction, will give you a feeling of this donut shape. If you're looking at the drawing here, it looks like that. That means every donut you rotate kind of this way, and the next one will rotate that way. So each one of them you are going to see a kind of a square cross section in there. Now, this bring right away a very distinguished feature of the curve flow instability from the parallel flow instability. Parallel flow, once it becomes unstable, it keeps going, it amplifies, and many, it keeps changing, continuous change. But you see, if a flow from a Couvert flow becomes unstable, then it becomes another stable flow just like this. Just lots of donuts stuck up, or lots of your tire, automobile tire, just kind of stuck up. You're just looking at it, and it is not moving in any way. It's just stable there. So there is a terminology I want you to write down in your note called principle of exchange of stability in the curve flow. Okay? Well, it's you said, what is this? Well, it says that in this rotating flow here, once it's become unstable, then it jumped to another level of the flow, but that flow is also stable. So there is no time dependent or anything there. Unlike atomic splitting, where once it's amplified, it keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going. So if you like, you can borrow this book. This book cited a couple of that reason why when you perform the curve flow instability, you throw away the time dependent term away. Now the reason make you throw it away, you can say that either you are strong in mathematics, you say, I know, I don't need the time-dependent term in there, I can have a solution. Or if you want to be more engineering or physics, like you say, I know the experiment, you see, I just jump from one stable flow, which is a simple Couper flow, to another more complicated flow, like this, and just stay there. So I know it, there's no time-dependent necessary for my analysis. So you say, I'm going to invoke the principle of exchange of stability and just do the analysis. So then you'll be able to analyze this as if it's a steady flow, but not simple Couvert, all right? And then if you're increasing the velocity more, then of course you get to another one. Now you may want to say, this is another level of a principle exchange of the stability, because you say, now my donut shape cannot keep it a straight donuts. Now the donuts must be like a deformed donuts, become a wiggle. Donuts there, and it stay that way. And so you keep going, 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 going back that way until you hit the turbulent, which looks something like that, some part laminar, some part turbulent, which is very, very messy. Okay? I'm not going to go through that detail. Essentially, you derive the disturbance equation for the curve flow. Do just the same like in the Cartesian coordinate. You take Navier-Stokes equation with instantaneous value, subtract the Navier-Stokes equation with average value, left you with a disturbance equation, throw away the small term, that means the infinitesimal disturbance square, you all throw them out, and that enable you to start the analysis. And then you impose a normal mode analysis one at a time. In the curve flow, you don't impose the time oscillation in there because you see the flow is stable. So you say, okay, I'm just looking at another level of the stability, and it's a space dependent on it. Okay, now, that was pretty much what we had the last time. Okay, today I passed out I just want to look at the result of a curve flow instability. As a matter of fact, you already see some picture already. But let's looking at kind of a tool quickly. There are lots of material I would leave to you to read it. First of all, this U, in this case, actually, is a rotating velocity. Okay, it's different from the other note there. It's a rotating velocity. If this is a rotating velocity after the analysis by Low Reddy, it shows that if a velocity profile is 1 over r to the n, and as long as this n is greater than 1, you can show it is going to be unstable. If r is equal to 1, what kind of flow you get it? Sometimes we call it the free vortex, right? The free vortex under the inviscid condition, it is still stable. So only just a little bit larger than that in n power there, and the profile beyond that one, everything is unstable. Okay? So that is Low Reddy also analyzed it. Okay, that is one thing I want you to recognize in the curve flow instability. Another one, now today the zoom power is pretty good, pretty clear. You can see here. Now you can see this is the concentric cylinder instability. And again, the name is called Taylor instability because this is G.I. Taylor first did it, Okay, so this is the GI Tera instability, so we call it the Tera instability. Now, there is another kind of a Tera instability is with respect to two-phase flow. Okay, if you have a two fluid, one heavy, one light here, and set it in there, there will be Tera instability that's going to do. There will be another Tera instability. But as far as the rotating goes, this is called Tera instability, okay? So sometimes we call this a Tera vortices or Tera vortex, okay? Now, I want you to look at this picture here. There's lots of similarity there. Actually, this plate could draw a little bit more curve. Actually, the plate is curved like this, and the boundary layer flow is coming toward me like that, okay? Now, even though this is only one plate here, there is no inside plate here, but you can almost imagine if there is a flow driving a flow goes through here and curve around this way, and without the inner cylinder there, as long as I created the flow here, because this is the flow where the inner cylinder rotates, right? So you may say that instead of inner cylinder, if I have a force flow blow on top of a curve flow here, your phenomena is going to see the same. If you say that not necessarily this curve must be a circular curve, but just any kind of curve, you are going to create a centrifugal force, okay? And therefore, you can almost imagine by knowing this analog of a flow here, you say this is going to happen. So that is to say, if I have a curved flow like this here, my flow is going this way, my boundary layer going this way, you are going to see a flow like this, or like this, many of the spacing in there, okay? Now, of course, you see this spacing of the cell size is pretty much controlled by the gap. And you can analyze it, essentially, it's a square. Whatever the gap there, you get it. So the larger gap, your cell will be larger. In narrower, it will be tiny like that. Okay? Now, this, of course, is controlled by your boundary layer, either momentum thickness or displacement thickness. Because you know it, once it gets up away from the boundary layer, then you no longer have the gradient, and the flow will be pretty much just like a smooth there. And this, of course, once it starts to rotate, it can suck up even farther out from the boundary layer because you know the curve flow, centrifugal force there, once it spreads out, it goes up. So boundary layer thickness may be like this, but the cell can go up pretty large there, okay? Now, this has a name right here, Gatra, okay? G-O-E-R-T-L-E-R, Gatra vortex in the boundary layer. Now, yes?
Taylor vortices, I've actually heard this one other time. They said they generally form into squares, right?
Mm-hmm.
How is it affected if your aspect ratio, height to width, isn't an integer? Like, let's say it's 8.5 widths high. Are you going to get 1/2?
You mean the 2n?
Yeah. So you don't have, they can't technically form squares because the aspect ratio is right.
If the total length is not the integer of that.
Do they just get slightly elongated or do you form a small one someplace?
Okay, make a guess. How intuitively, suppose we have a concentric cylinder, have a 2n plate covered with a certain non-integer there. What would you feel?
It would seem like they would just get a little bit longer.
Yes, the flow is going to adjust it, not to the immediate adjacent cell. It will adjacent from the boundary and get into the center portion, have a less interference. So the cell size is going to slightly change there. Actually, I did some experiment myself at Iowa. I find a 28 cell, and the length is not quite integer, and the center portion there is very close to what you get in the gap. Toward the end, you the cell will be a little bit flattened, or some of them will be a little bit elongated. Okay? So if you really want to generate Taylor vortex in its mathematical sense of a truly two-dimensional, you need much, much longer. You probably need about 30 or 40 cells, and then you claim that the center portion is independent of it. Okay. There was a time, there was an argument, how long you needed in order to get a center portion is truly Taylor. Yeah. Okay, now.
Well, can you choose it shorter if you just have some integral aspect ratio?
Well, suppose you choose only two. Mm-hmm. You probably get two cells.
Yeah.
But it's going to be distorted because your end viscosity is going to affect it. All right, but if you choose one and a half, what is going to happen? Depending on slightly, it may break in two cell, but maybe in one cell. Okay, so now there are lots of complications in the real application of a turbine, airplane, flame, anywhere, the ship. You can see the ship curve like this, and toward the end, you can see there is a gut level. So this curve flow instability is going to interact with the parallel flow instability. Because as you are looking like this, there will be another Thomson splitting wave going in this. This is the flow going this way. Thomson splitting wave is going to go like this, which the vortex is going to rotate this way. But this is going to go like this. And so now there is a competition of a inertial force, viscous force, and the centrifugal force. So it must get it right in order to get going. All right. So that will be a very, very, very complicated one there. Okay. Let me see where I can find. Okay. Now let's go back and visit this rotating again. See what kind of just a quick physical characteristic it'll give us. So I'm going to use. This figure a little bit. I think it's in one of your page there. This is an experiment of only the inner cylinder rotate. So if you're looking at the, it's closer here, you can see it's only the profile that the inside is rotating. Outside is stationary, okay? Now, the gap between is a small d, and the radius ri is the inside radius, and the inside omega is rotating. So you can define the so-called Taylor number. Taylor number is sort of a modified Reynolds number, as you can see. U being the rotating velocity, d being the gap, divided by the kinematic viscosity, and then you have a square root of a d over the r, okay? So now you can see the smaller the r, let's see if I can make, this is the largest I can go. Smaller the inside cylinder, that means the more the curvature involved, the larger the Taylor number is going to be, all right? So you can see that. So if this r is very large, like a cylinder is so big, and my gap is like this, so it will be only huge cylinder rotating like this, and only a gap like this, then you can see it's almost like a parallel flow, okay? So as R goes to infinity, you wipe out all the centrifugal force effect. So this is the modified of a Reynolds number with a curvature effect there. I would like to say that some people define the Taylor number is the square of this quantity. Okay, a square then mean that U will become like that, and you see all of this is a square. So I would like to show you this now. If I can pick up the first instability is a 41.3. Okay, it's over here. I wrote it down here. The first, let me say that the horizontal coordinate, of course, is the Taylor number. The vertical coordinate is the dimensionless torque. You see, you got to insert the torque, you know, to make it go. And measure that torque, make it dimensionless, and you can go and read the detail, rho u square, and then have a cross-section area and so forth. So it's called torque coefficient. Now, when the Taylor number is small, the torque coefficient is high, okay? And then in terms of, if it is a simple Coubert flow, then you know how the torque coefficient is going to change with the speed, so it is going to go down in like this. However, when the instability occurs, you see you take a long turn here and go like this and take another turn there. So you can see 41.3 in Taylor number is the first change from, it's the first principle of exchange of stability, okay? So you got in there. And it'll keep going, change until when you hit the turbulent, it has another curve there, okay? And some of the change in the critical number there is in the note. I'm not going to talk about it, okay? So this is the one well-known figure. I remember one of my classmates, PhD comprehensive oral exam was being asked, can you write a rotating cylinder and show how the torque is going to change with your rotating velocity? You got to remember which one it's going to deal with. Okay? I'm going to forego many other except I pass out this sheet. Okay? I want you to take a look of this one. There are many, many effects, the rotating versus axial velocity, all the density change and all of this. But I kind of feel that maybe some of the faculty may want to talk about this in the exam, because this, again, is one of the very basic figure. Everybody look at it in the stability book. What is this about? Let me amplify a little bit. In your note, I did not draw this and the color there. You can go and add it on. Here, the vertical coordinate is essentially the inside cylinder rotating speed, okay? And the right-hand side coordinate is the outside cylinder velocity in the same directions, okay? So I draw omega 1, omega 2 in the same directions, okay? Now, in the left-hand side here, which is rotating the counter, that means the inside rotating this way, outside rotating this way. So it's kind of go like this. Now, why we have to distinguish that one? Remember I said the Coriolis force is going to be different because one rotating inside this way, outside this way, somewhere in the middle got to have a zero velocity, no centrifugal force, but then the velocity switch, the Coriolis force, is going to switch. So you can see the combination of that one is going to create a different stability or the instability zone. So you can see anything above this curve here is unstable, and anything that below that one is going to be stable. And now you can see the rotating in the same direction with the same speed here seems to give you a little bit more stability zone. When you're rotating a counter speed there, you have a, you see, if you want to duplicate this curve, it should go up like that. But you see here, you do have an instability. So that is a shift of the Coriolis force created the problem for you. Okay, I think that should be enough. Although we can talk about the stability problem a lot, but yes. The rotating angular velocity, okay? And I think they, I don't know why they got to divide by the kinematic viscosity. Yeah. It's really not dimensionless anyway. Yeah. Okay, many other results, please go ahead and read it. If you are interested, I'll be happy to talk to you more. I want to move on to turbulence. Any question or suggestion up to this point?
What effect does the temperature gradient have? I mean, you haven't looked at.
Okay, if you want to talk about the temperature gradient, or maybe I can borrow this book. First, just like a curve flow, I isolate the parallel flow. So we talk about parallel flow, then you know Tomlin slipping is there. Talk about the curve flow, we just concentrate on the centrifugal force and Coriolis force action there, right? And then once you want to talk about the temperature effect, then temperature is going to affect what?
Density.
Your substance. Essentially the density, right? So temperature is going to affect your density. And the density, if you on the Earth, you have a gravitational field. So the temperature effect right away, you call it the thermal instability. Thermal instability, I just happen to have it here. I can kind of show you here. The title of a thermal instability. Okay, that's the temperature effect there. So what most of people talk about it here, let me show you, well actually let me show you this. What is this? Yeah, it's a Benard cell, you heard of it. And everyone possesses one in your home kitchen. Go home and take your fry pan, pour a little oil in there, watch it. You see, not as regular as this one, but you are going to see something like that. Normally your heating will be too much, so it quickly turns into turbulent, but you still see that cell. So you can see, you have a little bit of that. Why is this? Your pan tilted a little bit, so your depth of the oil is not uniform. Then you are going to get this. If you superpose a flow there, flow is going to look like this. In the picture, you are going to see a cell. This is actually very much, if you take your oil pan and heat it and just tilt it like this, you are going to see something like that happen. So essentially what come down to answer your question is that if you heat the fluid with the temperature effect there, and it's lighter here and cooler here, gravitational force work on this. So the heavier fluid tend to move down, lighter fluid tend to move up. Again, the conservation mass, what the portion comes out must be at the same time some portion goes down. So your flow motion goes like this. It come up in the center, like a volcano, you know, it's just coming up there and it's got to go down. And yet, they must have a pattern because you got to repeat the pattern if uniformly. Just by the mathematic, anyone want to see the mathematic? How many side of a pattern you can repeat the pattern? Well, how can you draw a picture that the pattern will repeat? Certainly, you don't draw anything, everything white. That can go infinity. You can draw a straight line. Every line is a straight line that you can continue on. So that means two-dimensional cell like this. So it's two sides. Instability can occur. How about three sides, triangle? Yes, triangle, if it's the right triangle, you can always patch it up, repeat it. How about four sides? Yes, you can draw a rectangle, you can draw a square, it can repeat it, so it will happen this way. How about the pentagon, five sides? Once you draw the pentagon, you cannot repeat it because the angle is so funny, you'll never be able to patch it. So instability, pentagon side never happened. How about six sides? You're looking at it, okay, hexagonal. Seven sides, no. Eight sides, no. Nine sides, no. 10, 11, 12, infinity, no. So the instability occur can be have a two-dimensional, three sides, four sides, not five, six sides, that's all. So the instability, in the thermal instability happen, you can have those patterns. And that has been proved. The most stable one is a six side, and that is normally you will see. You see the weatherman introduce high pressure, low pressure comes in. You see, there is all that essential is that size. of course, the Earth is rotating, so it's a temperature effect, adding the rotating effect, Coriolis, centrifugal force, everything all mixing there. That's why weather is so hard to predict. not to mention you have a snow and a rain and everything, magnetic field added on, and that makes Professor O'Brien famous, because he's the only one who has a program can calculate all of this mixed together. So. Okay, any other comment on the instability? Okay, if not, I really anxious want to move on to turbulence now. So we'll move to part three. I come right at it, I call the modeling of incompressible turbulent flow. Incompressible, again, I want to isolate the density effect, high speed effect, acoustic effect, all of those. Some of you may be working with Professor Crosparty, who is interested in the acoustic added on, the compressibility, and so forth. But I will leave, after we understand the basic, then you can take off in that direction. So incompressible with the first order business we really got to deal with. I say modeling is because, as I said, like an engineer, or maybe some physicists, they want to know in advance before things get bad on you or before things occur, okay? Like we want to design the car which is safe, so that means you got to know in advance. So if we want to predict some flow before we build anything in the engineering device, we got to be able to model. Model means that if you have a what is a model? If a model is only good for one particular flow, then it's no longer a model. That means you can create a model, and you do an experiment to verify it, and this model will be good for the other situation, and that is a good model. And a good model, that means you have a lot of prediction capability. So Navier-Stokes equation is very, very good fluid model. Even though we are restricted only Newtonian fluid, but ever overlapping, all of us make a life out of a Navier-Stokes equation. Usually. So we all live with this model. So to do the modeling, and the reason of need modeling is that we try to avoid the direct numerical simulation Navier-Stokes equation now. So we're looking at the modeling. But before we do that, I have a first important idea I want to impart with you is an order of magnitude estimate. And all of this is my writing. Probably not many people do the same way as I write. I apologize for my not very clear writing, but anyway, you get the material from me. So after we talk about order of magnitude, then we'll zoom in the detail of the turbulence modeling. Now, I should explain why order of magnitude is important to me. I should give a credit to my advisor, Simon Ostrak. He's coming next month for the Engineering Advisory Council meeting. And maybe some of my students want to see him. I'll be happy to introduce. So you can see the advisor's advisor. So. When I was studying with him, because my doctor thesis is a very complicated one, as I said, it's a rocket reentry. A rocket nose will melt because the shock wave, behind the shock wave, temperature is 4,000, 5,000 degree of temperature. So we cannot even do an experiment at that temperature, right? The shock tube you can use in a hydrogen shock tube can create that, but you cannot create that melting. So what I did is do the modeling by scaling the very high temperature into a low temperature. So actually, I essentially melt the ice cream. I melt the oil, put in the liquid nitrogen, and free the ice candy. Our motor oil freeze in the liquid nitrogen is such a nice looking coffee color, coffee candy. I kind of want to eat it. But then I put in the wind tunnel, blow the hot air on it, which is like a room temperature of 100 degrees, so it'll melt. So we have a theory to say that the rocket nose high temperature melting is equivalent to some degree, not to complete simulation, but somewhat to simulate, it's a low temperature melting. So with all of those melting going on, and he keep asking me, don't try the detail analysis yet. Just go and estimate what you have. How thick is your liquid layer? How much the melting you are going to get? What is the interface temperature? What is the depth of the gas layer on top of the liquid melting layer, and so forth. So I inherited that idea. So my thesis has done a lot of order magnitude analysis. As it turned out, it's very good. And he shuffled several master students, asked me to advise, because they are doing experiment. They need a parameter to clean up their data. And the order magnitude estimate give you the reference scale, everything. And you can plot all the experiment and collapse into one curve. So with that, I'm going to go to the order magnitude analysis of the turbulent flow. So why the order magnitude is so important, I want to, some of you heard me say before, if I using your daily life as an example, I say, Mr. King, after the class, let's go eat hamburger. Give an order estimate of how much money you need. I didn't say exactly where we are going to eat, but you say, well, can I go to eat? McDonald's, $2. Go to Crystal River. Or go to some steakhouse. You say, I probably need $15. So what you are doing, you don't go to the precise calculation of how much tip I get, the tax, and which dish I'm going to order, right? You don't go into that one right away. Right away in your mind, boom, how much? I say, let's go see movie. I say, where movie? I say, Capitol Plaza. He say, how long will it take? 20 minutes, right? So you estimate something very quick, right? So it's the same thing, go to the turbulent. I say, let's talk about the turbulent boundary layer. Do you have an idea that if I give you a Reynolds number of 10 to the 6, how thick is the boundary layer? Without knowing that one, you are already talking about what is my fluctuation, what is my spectrum, and what is my correlation. I think that's out of order, right? So we got to talk about the order magnitude first. See, if you understand the general aspect of it first, then we zoom into the detail. So for that reason, I got to talk about the order magnitude analysis. And indeed, when myself was studying all the turbulence book, it seems to always bother me. I said, before I know how thick this is going to be, you already tell me vortex spectral, make this correlation, and you find this kernel, and so you can integrate that one. And I think I don't feel very comfortable with that. So to drive home my idea, I'm going to call it the order magnitude analysis. So let's look in at the turbulent boundary layer, OK? Now, let me show you this picture again, and let's look at a couple pictures. Okay, this is the boundary layer flow from here, go this way with a kind of smoke streak in there, you can see, and maybe the hydrogen bubble. And you can see lots of turbulence going on here, not so much turbulence there and here. Now, you are looking at this, of course, you know the layer thickness probably that much high. But suppose I just give you turbulent flow is here, and the Reynolds number is such and such here, and I say, give me the order of magnitude, or how thick one is. And maybe I will ask where this the highest fluctuation layer is. Okay, you can think this way, all right? Here is a wall. Here is the edge of the boundary layer. But you see inside, you see no fluctuation here, right? No fluctuation here. So somewhere must have a maximum fluctuation. I say, go and find out that maximum fluctuation location. I wouldn't say very precise. It's approximately. Okay? Probably you pointed maybe about here, right? So you can see, just looking at this picture, you already know this maximum fluctuating layer to the wall is much smaller than this layer to that layer, okay? So let's kind of divide our idea of looking at the turbulent boundary layer into our laminar concept of a total layer. Let's call that the outer layer. And the inner layer, which is very inside here, and and to the wall. Okay, so let's. So now our question is, giving a flow, can I find some relation? If I cannot really predict it, but I got to find some relations. Is the surface roughness, the wind tunnel intensity, or my speed, my density, my viscosity, is that all, everything related to deciding how this layer is going to behave? Before we, if we can do it in a very simple way, even though it's an approximate way, you get a, you catch the idea very quick that way, okay? So now let's looking at the this. So this is my way of drawing. Give you a boundary layer, the line I draw essentially is the outer layer, okay? Is the total boundary layer. Now I already proposed to show you, you can see this picture I draw here, the red one, and I give it a little bit larger fluctuation here, show you just see in the picture there. So I said that if there are somewhere we can understand this turbulent boundary layer a little bit better, so I propose that, well, why don't we look at it this way? I have a dot line there, putting a dot line there, and that is my K maximum. You can see K now is going to define as a fluctuation square, okay? You can take a U, you see the fluctuation here, you are looking at it here. It's not necessary only the horizontal fluctuation or vertical or three-dimensional. But anyway, you can take it, K is a U square fluctuation, V square fluctuation, W square fluctuation divided by 2, which is the turbulent kinetic energy, all right? So let's say we identify that is roughly that. Now, in order to solve this one, what I'm going to do? Can I just blindly guessing or go to the fortune teller, say, okay, go and draw the fortune, tell me what this one is. Okay, that is not very scientific. But you all know it, the turbulent phenomenon, all fluid phenomenon, you cannot get away from Navier-Stokes equation, right? So we will go to the Navier-Stokes equation. Now, so we would give it a little bit of name here. See if I can zoom a little bit more here. Okay. I'm going to call from here to there is a Y delta. This delta is not very clear, but it's a delta show that it's a small layer. Now I'm going to call this inside here, only this much, is Y delta I, subscript I, that means denote the inner layer there, okay? Now I'm also going to label this K maximum, that means the fluctuation, turbulent kinetic energy is the largest, is related to the U infinity, I have a 2-0 square there, that is the approaching velocity, okay? Any flow comes in here, which is approaching velocity square. Because K actually is the velocity square, so I got to have a plus square. Then I got that proportionality. For example, I may have a 10 meter per, hold on, okay. We'll change tape.
No, you can finish and get to a break.
Oh, you, when you say this is 2 minutes. Okay. So you can see the proportionality, if I have a 10 meter per second there, my fluctuation may be 1 meter, so you can see that's a 10%, right? So I'm going to be using a kinetic energy versus kinetic energy, this is the mean kinetic energy, this is the fluctuating kinetic energy, and the proportion that one is the ratio of it, I'm going to call it the turbulent intensity, okay? So we are going to call that is the turbulent intensity. And I said that for a normal wind tunnel, you are going to find the I is like a 1% or 5%, depending on the how good your wind tunnel is. So that is to say, the fluctuation you give it to a boundary layer here, compared with the mean flow going through here, is about 1%. It's a very good wind tunnel. The 5% is a little bit rough tunnel in there. So, but that is a tonal. But now we want to find out, is this fluctuation has anything to do deciding this layer, deciding this layer or not? Okay? So that is the idea we try to find out. Okay, now, we have not talked about the Reynolds stress, have we? We have not taken the average of the Navier-Stokes equation. Okay, let me go ahead and talk about this, the idea here first. Okay, the next things I want to do is that I know I cannot go to the fortune teller, ask for just any pull out of his magic bag and say, this is it. So I got to rely on the equation, the conservation equation. Now, how I'm going to get a very simple information out of conservation equation is that I got to make it dimensionless. Why I want to make it dimensionless, then I don't have to talk about the apple and oranges because everything is dimensionless. So I said, this ratio is 1, that ratio is 1. So be it be velocity ratio or boundary layer ratio, they'll be all in dimensionless language. Okay, so that's one. Second, I got to go to my equation to solve it. And I know all my conservation equation, be it mass, momentum, or the energy equation, they are all in partial differential equation now. I don't want to solve partial differential equation. So I'm going to solve a very simple algebraic equation out of it. So in order to simplify my analysis, I'm going to make my dimensionless quantity, whatever the quantity I want to create, make it about of order 1, and change from 0 to 1. About 1, and its range is changing from 0 to 1. Why I'm doing that one? If it's order 1, then all my variable make it dimensionless will be about 1. All my derivative, first derivative, change the dimensionless. X change from 0 to 1. V change from 0 to 1. Then I can expect the first derivative will be about 1. So I'm creating an order. Mathematically, you have an order, say 0, 10, 100, and so forth. I'm trying to create the dimensionless variable, and its first derivative will be about of order 1. So you can see, instead of really solving a partial differential equation, whatever the derivative quantity come out, I'm going to say this is roughly 1, this is roughly 1. What's left, factor out in the equation there, I'm going to try to analyze it, okay? So with that in mind, I'm going to make a velocity divided by the u velocity. Then I know it is about 1. It also changed from 0 to 1 because at the wall there's no velocity. Out here, velocity is infinite, the free stream velocity. So I know velocity changed from 0 to 1. All right? Now, my v velocity, which is the boundary layer vertical side of velocity, I do not know. I do have a boundary layer flow coming here. I do know my flow velocity. But I do not know how much the velocity is going this way. Okay? Since I do not know, I don't want to pretend I know it. So I'm going to make it the v, this is dimensionless, small character there. The u, small character is dimensionless, this is dimensional. So I'm going to divide by the u free stream velocity, but certainly it will not give me 1 because I don't know. At least I have a feeling this velocity is much smaller than this velocity. So I said I got to time some fractions, okay, which is the triangular delta there, so I can make it 1. So now you said, well, you create a trouble for yourself. You don't know this delta. But I say, okay, the unknown variable is what you are going to solve, okay? If you know what is the fraction of what the v velocity is, what percentage of this velocity, you get some information solved already, okay? So just like I said, how thick is the boundary layer, how thick is the inside layer there. So since Y side, I'm going to there. So since Y side, I'm going to apply to the boundary layer here. So I'm Y, but I do not know how thick is my boundary layer. So I'm going to using a Kronecker type of the delta L there. L is the length of my plate I'm going to look at. So it's the location. If this is the location, I'm going to look at this boundary layer. So this will be delta L there, okay? So I'm going to divide by that one, make Y is also 1, okay? And now, all the Navier-Stokes equation I'm going to impose, the instantaneous velocity is the average velocity plus the fluctuating velocity with a subscript I in there. And so is the pressure and the temperature, but we don't want to talk about the temperature right now. So the correlations of a two velocity, U and V, and I put the bar there is that I time the two quantity and the bar, we already talked about how we want to take the average, which is the ensemble average, okay? If it is a steady state mean flow, and then you can use the Reynolds average also there. So now, these two fluctuation quantity, which is going to give you, in some sense, like a Coriolis force. You say you have a U and V time together, which will give you the shear. So what is this fluctuation of a velocity is going to behave? Suppose Ken and I is jogging on the field. We are running, right? Now, if we are running, I always a little bit faster than you, such as like I'm the outside the boundary layer, you are inside lane. So I'm going a little bit faster, then we are in a lamina. But if we are angry each other, so we are turbulent, so we are hitting each other, or maybe I pick up so many gravel or stone, throw at you, and you got to catch it, right? Now you can see I'm running faster than you, so when I throw at you, when you catch it, what is going to happen? You are going to get jerked forward. Now you throw it back to me because you are slower velocity, so when I catch it, I cannot go as fast, I got to go back a little bit. So that exchange is essentially this velocity. You see, I'm a little bit faster than you, okay? And I also throw a stone to you. There is another particle go to this direction. So I have a U fluctuating. I'm a little bit faster than you. And you throw at the ball, U to me, fluctuating to me. When I catch it, the feeling I got, that the inertial force change is this. And that we sometimes call the stress, either the normal stress or the shear stress. If we are running parallel and exchange the stone this way, then it's shear because you see shear. But if you are running ahead of me and running behind you, and I just want to go faster, but I have no other place to go, what I'm going to do, I'm going to give you a push. And that is a normal stress because I give you a normal stress. So you can see that if I write the U and V fluctuation here, that is shear. If I U and U, then it's normal. V and V, which is normal. Okay. So any cross that one will give you that feeling there. So you can see when you see a turbulence going on here, now you can physically feel what I say. This layer is exchanging the stone because it's a fluctuate. And in addition to the mean, what they are doing is either I'm pulling faster or you pull me slower. And of course, what happened is the outside layer is always a little bit faster. So it is always imparting a little bit more force to the next layer. And next layer get it, he get excited, go faster, and so he give it to another layer. That's why the turbulent boundary layer have a larger shear near the wall, because when you end up here, you have the momentum kind of keep pass on. Yeah, you get a little bit larger in there, okay? So with that in mind, we are going to make all the variable to dimensionless, and hopefully it will change from 0 to 1. So for example, the pressure we divide by the rho u squared. Why we do that? You can look at the Biruni equation. Biruni equation, you have a u squared divided by that, and then you have p over rho term. So they are about equal, right? So you can divide it that way. We are also try to make the x variable dimensionless, so divide by the length. Certainly that is very appropriate, which will be order 1. You start from the tip to the location you're looking at, change 0 to 1. So now I can talk about the dimensionless variable, partial u, partial x. You see, the u variable now I make it dimensionless, so change from 0 to 1. X change from 0 to 1, so I can claim whatever the derivative, I make it dimensionless. I'm going to call it of order 1. OK, so now I am jumping ahead. Maybe next time when we have a class again, I'll go through the averaging of a Navier-Stokes equation one more time. But for example, the continuity equation, you certainly have no problem with it. Let me put it here. I'm just looking at the two-dimensional for now, okay? So the U, capital U, make it dimensionless like this, just dimensionless. V is dimensionless, Y dimensionless. So now you know I'm using delta for dimension, make it dimensionless of a V quantity, and make a Y with this delta for the dimensionless, then of course my continuity equation is going to get something like that. Okay? Now, before I move on, if you're looking at this equation here, what I'm going to do with it, I'm going to call this is of order 1, because as I say, u change from 0 to 1, x change from 0 to 1, v change from 0 to 1, y change to 1. So I have a logical, I have a logic set up, say, approximately my first derivative is about 1. Okay? Just like your mathematical variable, this side changes from 0 to 1, just change to 1. And then most likely your derivative will be somewhere sort of like this. Unless in the extreme funny case, go like this, go like that. Most of them you can expect to be of order 1. Okay? Now, this is of order 1. So now, if this is the order 1, that is the order 1. If these two ratio, the triangle delta and the Kronecker delta is not 1, then you are in trouble, because then you get this 5 out. So this derivative cannot be equal to 0, because that should be equal to 1. So that way, right away, leads you to the conclusion delta is what? The triangle delta is this velocity fraction of to denote how much the v velocity I got is tied in to this boundary layer thickness. Okay? So now you can see physically it's telling me what? If I have a large boundary layer thickness, you can see this is the delta. Okay? So that the Kronecker delta is large, that means I have a larger boundary layer thickness. If I have a larger boundary layer thickness, means what? I have a larger upward velocity in there, because of these two got to be the same. So if I say that, you can see, if I look at this boundary layer, of course, I don't, or maybe we can look at this. Looks like a boundary layer start from here and grow up in here, right? So you may want to say, actually, maybe I'm stretching a little bit far. Let's say the boundary layer here, you say this is the 10% of this length. If I say that, if we agree that is, looks like a 10% is the boundary layer thickness. If it is 1 cent, 10% there, then that means this is the 10%, so the delta will be 10%. So you see the V velocity is also about 10% of your mean velocity. You never know that until you go to the this equation and make that approximation. So if my boundary layer is very thin here, 1%, then I say V velocity is about 1% of the free stream velocity. Okay? So that's an interesting result, okay? Even though it looks so simple, but who said the simple is bad? Right? Einstein, the energy equation is so simple, but so well now. So we may call, if you like, call this the fluid basic. Actually, what we get out of this? This actually is a consequence of conservation of mass. But you see, the conservation of mass tell you the relation of a velocity versus the length there, and that give you this right away. Okay, now I can do the same thing here by saying now I want to looking at this inner layer. Remember we talk about, we want to look at this maximum fluctuating layer. So this layer versus from here to here, okay? So if I say that now instead of looking at the whole layer there, I'm just going to look at this layer here. So I'm going to using delta I L to denote that tiny layer. So then what I'll do, the fraction of this velocity now applied to the inside layer, I'm going to attack along the triangular with the I here. This is not very clear, this is the U infinity. I apologize for that. Actually, it's just the same quantity here. I said or, that means the inside in there. So that is to say, if I apply to this layer, and then the same thing, same result will lead me to say that the delta I is also this delta I. So if I have a thinner layer here, then the velocity very close to that one is also smaller. So that is to say, now if I have a very large layer here to here, then my velocity here will be about the same percentage of this. But if I'm looking at here, this layer thickness, then the velocity here will be small. So it almost, the V velocity is almost kind of linearly proportional where your layer is looking at it. Now, you may be thinking, what the Professor Chen is doing all this? It's kind of funny. I never heard of anything this. Maybe in the next hour, when we get together, you are going to see a great result. Now, before we finish the class, yeah, let me say this. Do you prefer to solve three-dimensional unsteady? Flow to start with, you say no. Then I said, how about two-dimensional steady flow? You say, yeah, I like it, right? And I said, why don't you solve a one-dimensional equation, which is ODE? Two-dimensional is PDE. You hate the PDE more. How about ODE? Right away you say, yeah. But I said, let's not solve ODE. Why don't we solve algebraic equation? Wouldn't you jump up, joy? You say, I go back to high school. I only use algebraic equation. That is exactly what we are doing. You see, we change the conservation of mass equation from partial differential equation right into a very simple. It's too simple that you won't believe it. This is an algebraic equation relating the two very physically important, the vertical velocity fraction versus boundary layer thickness. Now, you said, gee, this looks good. Why don't we move on to momentum equation? Then I say, you are going to get a very, very good candy to eat. It's so simple and so physically revealing. For example, now I can talk to all my colleagues, say that if you have a rough surface, give me the turbulent intensity there. If I know the turbulent intensity, I almost know how much the boundary layer thickness is going to be. And if you give me the turbulent intensity, I can almost tell your skin friction coefficient in the turbulent flow is going to be how big. You see, this is all come from momentum equation because it's essentially the balance of the force or viscous force versus the turbulent. And by momentum equation, you equate it,
You don't have to solve 3D equation. You don't have to solve 2D equation. You don't have to solve 1D equation. All you are solving is algebraic equation. And that is what I call the order magnitude analysis, because 3D indeed is more precise than 2D. 2D is more precise than ODE. ODE is more precise than algebraic. But you get a simplicity and overall picture quick. So I've been joking with many of my students before. You want to be an engineer. You want to take a project that takes 3 years to solve, or 1 year, or 10 days, or 1 day, or 1 hour, or 1 minute. You said, Ms. Trenko, you're going to say, are you kidding, 1 minute solution? I said, I'm not kidding. If you hire a consultant for troubleshooting, he said that our room seems to not have enough air circulation. He just thinks 30 seconds, he give you the answer. You see, 1 minute analysis. He said, oh, your duct is too small, or your motor is too small, not enough. You see, so it's the same thing. You get a very complicated problem. What do you do? You don't want to spend 3 years right away or something. You go and estimate 5 minutes, 10 minutes, or 1 day or 2 day, quickly clean up all the algebraic analysis. Then you know, oh, I roughly know what kind of answer I'm going to get. But for my PhD, my committee will not pass me with the algebraic analysis, so I got to go and do a 3D analysis. And then you spend 3 years, crank out all the detail, and then you graduate. Okay. Okay. So I will stop here. So I would emphasize that order magnitude analysis is important. It will help you physically thinking about what you got the problem you got on hand. Okay, Donna, that's all.